Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Dr. Theresa Chen's Piano Jazz at TAMUK series. Today's guest is Austin-based pianist Damian Garcia. Mr. Garcia is an alumni of the University of North Texas and a past member of the 2 O'Clock Live Band. He shares his favorite memories and more exclusively with Peter Lee and Bob Minson. Please enjoy the show.
All right, so welcome back to TAMUK, Damian.
Thank you.
Okay. So this is actually the very first series of the time, in the format of piano jazz. So before we start our first tune, how about you talk a little bit about your relationship to TAMUK? And your background and other relationship to this school?
Yeah, so I was here at TAMUK from 2005 to I think 2007 or 2008, and it was one of the first schools that I attended in my journey to do jazz piano. And back then, the jazz studies degree was not a thing, so. If you've been following the jazz festival that happens here every year, the program is very different than it was back then. The players were not anywhere near the level that they are now. I was back here in November and I was really surprised at the musicianship, because the kids now could have easily played circles around all of us when we were in school in 2005, you know? But my relationship with this school, it goes back a while, because my dad actually came here as a student as well, and he was doing music education. And then when I was about to graduate from high school, I wasn't really sure if I was gonna do music or not. I had toyed around with the idea of doing architecture and graphic design. And then I think I just got too lazy about the application, and I was like, well, I guess I'll just do music. And then at that time, there was really no other option for me other than to do classical piano. So that's what I auditioned on. So I was a classical piano major here up until I transferred to Texas State. And then from Texas State, I went to North Texas. And I also did a year at Berkeley doing jazz composition. And then I came back and ultimately finished at UNT in 2015. So I took the scenic route for education. But the interesting thing was that I didn't have a teacher for a long, long, long time. Like, my first lesson was not, my first jazz lesson was like way, way later, like in 2012. So I spent a lot of time kind of just self-teaching, and I think most of the guys that I went to school with here in Kingsville, they were also sort of self-teaching, because in this area, there's not really that much, I mean, there's not really that many jazz teachers, you know? I mean, since the degree got started, I think that's the first introduction of a legit jazz instruction in this area, right?
Yeah, I think we will hear more about that experience. So how about, let's start some tune. So what tune would you like to start with?
We can try Dancing in the Dark.
That's what I was thinking, as a good opener. Let's do it.
Thank you.
Wow, what a tune! You know, this is one of the rare standards that I've played not many often, but thank you for the good call. It really got me really, really hard work, you know. The first time I heard this tune, it was from Rini Rosnes and Bill Shalov's album from Portrait, right?
The one that I sent you.
Yeah, the one you sent me kind of reminded me of that, right? So when you first heard that performance, how was your feeling?
It was really interesting because I know there's a lot of people here who haven't really seen this kind of setup before. You know, two pianos playing jazz. Usually when you see two pianos, it's going to be like concerto accompaniment style. You know, they're side by side. So I think that was one of the first two piano albums that I had checked out. And I really, really liked a lot of the tunes that they were doing. The great thing about this format is anything can happen because you have two people controlling the harmony. And like, for example, that what we just played, there was some stuff that we talked about, but once the tune starts, we really don't know what's gonna happen. Like, we have to listen in on each other, and there's a lot of things that are floating around depending on what she plays and what I play, so the tune can go in any direction. And that's what's really fun about doing this style. It's very different from playing with like a bass player.
Yeah, so would you mind sharing your experiences in UNT, especially on the part of dual piano experiences with everyone here?
Yeah, when I was at UNT, we had, you know, the jazz piano lessons, and usually the teacher is the one that plays with us. And so we did a lot of two piano stuff in that situation, but believe it or not, this is actually the first time I perform in two piano, which is kind of crazy because I'm 37 and I've been a professional musician for a long time, and this is the first time that I've ever done this before. But my experience at UNT was great. I'm very thankful for how stressed out I was during that time, and I don't think that I would have learned the same thing. For me, I think going to that school at that moment was very beneficial because there was a lot of necessary stress that I had to endure and a lot of things that I had to get familiar with so that I can go to the next level of musicianship. I had auditioned at a bunch of other schools too. And like, for example, I auditioned at UT and I didn't get accepted. And the teacher had told me, the jazz piano teacher at the time, I had went in with a stack of real books. I deserved it. I deserved not to get in. I deserved the beat down that he gave me. He's like, you're coming in here with your fake books and you need to work on your left hand vocabulary, you need to have all these tunes memorized. And he just went down the list, and it was after that experience that I had come back to TAMUK, and I was just like practicing in the practice room for like a whole year. And then I went to eventually I transferred to Texas State, and I met that teacher, and he didn't recognize me anymore because I had lost a bunch of weight when I was here. I used to be pretty big. But then I went back, and he's like, man, you sound so great. Like, are you new in town? Like, what's your name? And we had met before. He just didn't remember that he was the one that didn't really accept me into the program. So I learned a lot, you know, from going through that. There's a lot of tough love, I think, that you have to go through to grow as a musician and not take it personally.
Yeah, I do agree with that.
You're really good about that too, because you take you take feedback very constructively. You know, when you were at Eastman, you were telling me a lot of stories.
Well, it was just maybe such a blessing that I had the opportunity to study jazz in the U.S. I was very much determined to come here because back at that time, there was no jazz program in Taiwan. Only happened in the extracurricular clubs or maybe the off-school programs or private institute. But that means a lot to me. And, you know, coming out of jazz institution and did the schooling, it means a lot to me. Even though it might not apply to everybody, but I think it works in different ways. It differs from person to person. Mm. So myself.
You mean like your experience studying jazz at the university level?
Yeah, yeah. It's especially starting myself as a master student instead of an undergrad. Mm.
So. Yeah, I will add that just because you're in a certain scene or a certain city, it doesn't mean that you should write off the experience. What you should try to do is learn as much as you possibly can from the resources that are available to you. Even if you're in a town like Kingsville, doesn't really have the active jazz scene that like Dallas or Austin has. I live in Austin, so when I come down here, all the students are super excited about going to Austin and trying to you know, cut their teeth on the jam sessions there. But you still have a lot of opportunities to grow, and if you really want to grow at a faster level, it would be very beneficial for you to ask for critical feedback and don't take it personally, because everybody wants you to succeed, especially all the faculty and any teacher that you've ever had. Our goal is to have you be better than we are, you know, to play better than us. So anything that we tell you is pretty much out of love, a love for the music and love for the student.
Oh yeah, let's play another tune.
Yeah.
It'll be my turn to call the tune.
Sure.
How about Pensativa by Clare Fischer?
Thank you.
gosh, Clare Fischer. Clare Fischer was my main musical influences back at the time when I was studying Eastman. My then professor, Bill Dahman's one out of the four, he kind of introduced the tunes to me. And I first got fascinated by the transcription that he did from Clare Fischer's solo album, Just Me. And that transcription just happened to be in my doctoral comp written exam. And because of the long transcription, I was not able to finish the analysis on time because it was so long, oh man. So, but I still fell in love with it. That tune. What do you think?
I think that's the first time that I play that tune.
I cannot tell.
Yeah, it's kind of hard actually. Maybe that's why a lot of people don't call that tune because it's pretty hard. The thing about these Clare Fischer tunes is, I think they have their characteristic. The main characteristic is they tend to modulate to a bunch of different keys. Mm-hmm. But the interesting is that the modulations happen so seamlessly. Like it starts in G flat and then it goes to C, which is kind of weird.
that could be really tricky though. So I just share my early one of the jazz piano influences on me. And what about your main influences? What's your influence?
Oh man, I think when I first started with jazz, I didn't listen to a lot of piano players actually. I really wanted to be a saxophone player. Whoa. And when I was in middle school, I had the option of choosing French horn, flute, and clarinet. And both of my parents played French horn, and they told me if I ever pick up that instrument that I will never be able to go back home. So French horn was out. And then definitely I didn't want to be a flute player because for obvious reasons. So the other thing that I was left for was clarinet. And so I didn't really like the instrument, to be honest. I kind of hated it, but I decided to be good at it. So I was practicing a lot on this instrument. The whole time wanted to be a saxophone player. So then, when I started piano at age 5, I stopped lessons for quite a bit of time, and then I joined middle school jazz band, and then high school jazz band is kind of when we started getting really serious about it. And then I started listening to a lot of music, but it was mostly saxophone players. I was listening to a lot of Sonny Stitt, a lot of Paul Desmond, and a lot of Stan Getz. A lot of Chet Baker. I think one of my first memories transcribing music was transcribing Chet Baker vocal solos, like a lot of like the scat solos that he was doing. And also I was transcribing a lot of other saxophone solos. But I think as far as piano goes, I was learning a lot from Kenny Barron and Oscar Peterson, especially this one recording, Night Train, that I wore out. Like, I listened to that thing so many times, and still, like, I go back to that record, and it sounds so good. It doesn't even sound good, it just feels good. You don't even have to really, like, listen. It's just, like, everybody's locked in, and that's such a great record. And then other influences were, like, my parents were into jazz a lot, so I grew up listening to a lot of jazz, and salsa, and Latin jazz, so Dinah Crawl was like another big influence. My first jazz record was Dinah Crawl, Live in Paris, and Kind of Blue, Miles Davis. Those are my first two albums. Do you remember yours?
I remember the first jazz album that I had was by I think it was from a Sweden group playing early jazz, which I never thought of getting into so much early jazz, but that was definitely the first jazz recording. So the leader of the album, his name, a sax player and woman doubler, plays Broda. Obviously, this is like a lesser known name. So that because of that album, I started to transcribe the horn solos instead of the piano solo.
Yeah.
And
also, same thing.
Yeah.
I remember listening to Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. Too, in high school.
Oh.
And that was way over my head, but I was like, man, this guy's definitely not human.
Oh my
He's
God.
Like an alien. or something.
Yeah, Chick Corea, right?
Yeah, Chick Corea. I remember we used to have these jam sessions in high school, and I spent like 4 hours trying to figure out what a fourth voicing was that Chick was playing.
Oh.
And I was like, what is this voicing? This guy's weird.
Yeah.
I couldn't get it. It was way over my head. And then when I got to TAMUK, I was like, oh, that's a fourth.
Yeah, may he rest in peace, Chick Corea. Yeah. Always our fear. So let's play Chick Corea too. Let's play one. Love Castle.
Oh, okay.
Let's do Love Castle.
Get into it.
From the album, Spanish Heart, My Spanish Heart.
Thank you.
I did not expect this transition to happen to me. Oh my gosh. This tune was called, of course, Damian, by Damian himself. Tell us what the tune is.
Oh, let me get some water.
I don't know. I have a similar kind of body quality that is like cactus, you know, because I sometimes just don't really drink water for a long period of time, and I did not feel thirsty or anything, so that's why I call myself a cactus. So, what's the tune? Tell us.
Oh yeah, this tune, it's actually a tune that I had brought up to Theresa, because I don't think that you had heard this one before, right? And I became familiar with this one from this Fred Hirsch recording of him doing solo piano at the BIM house in Amsterdam. And I was like, man, this is such a cool tune. And I wanted to bring it in and see how it sounded, because I've heard this tune with trio and in solo piano, but I don't think there's any version of like two people. I think there's a version of Julian Lage playing with Fred Hirsch on an album.
I did not know
yeah,
that.
It's brand, I think it just came out though. Anyway, most of these tunes, I was curious to see how they would sound with two pianos, because when I got here on Tuesday, we really didn't have any idea about how these were going to come out, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of like the cool part about it too. When we got here and we were talking through some of the tunes, we had rehearsed just a little bit just so that we could have some endings and beginnings figured out. But for the most part, a lot of these tunes I've never played with another piano player.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And so, especially this one. This one was interesting to pull off, and it was fun. It was fun, too.
Yeah, I agree.
Especially that transition and all the stuff that we did that we actually didn't rehearse before. It just kind of came out.
Yeah, when Damian brought this tune to me, I literally did not know this tune before. And when I was sign-reading the melody, I was like, oh man, this is so moving. It's so lyrical that I just got more and more into that. Another good call, Damian. So how about sharing with us about your international travels? I mean, different, especially Asian countries. And
oh yeah. I actually had never traveled outside of the country until 2019. That was my first time. And I went to Japan, and it was such an awesome experience, because I had never left the country, and going straight into a city like Japan and experiencing the culture and the jazz scene, which was also really eye-opening too. I mean, there was a whole different world of how people do things over there, and the musicianship was unbelievable. But I ended up going there every 3 months. I went there 6 times. I'm going back again in March for the 7th time. And what I really got to appreciate was experiencing music outside of your little bubble of familiarity. Because you think music is a universal language, and it is, but when you're trying to go to a jam session in Japan, and like, I don't know if most of you know this, but nobody speaks English in Japan. What you see in animes and all that stuff is a lie. Nobody speaks English. And so I got there and I was like, oh shit, you know? I need somebody to interpret and take me to places, because all the menus were in Japanese and everything was in Japanese. All the musicians, you know, we'd play and it sounded amazing and we'd have such good chemistry. And then afterwards, it would be just 45 minutes of Google Translate showing each other what we were trying to do or trying to say, you know? But that trip was really great, because it was like a catalyst for me to explore other parts of the world. So I went to Korea and I did the same thing there. I had friends that I went to school with at UNT and who were able to show me around, a lot of jazz musicians in Korea. I went to a jam session, and they do things differently than they do in Japan. And then when Theresa got the job here, she invited me to come in November, and I was originally going to go to Hong Kong, but she was talking about Taiwan, and I knew nothing about Taiwan. We had some friends there from UNT that that were living there, but for the most part, it was kind of a new world. So I was planning to go to Hong Kong, and she was like, well, you should check out Taiwan. There's a lot of good musicians there, and I can connect you with this guy and this guy and this guy. And before I knew it, you know, I was on a plane to Taiwan, and I was there in November, and I had picked up a little bit of Mandarin, just like the basic phrases. And when I got there, it was so underrated. Like, Taiwan is the most underrated country out of all Asia, in my opinion, because everybody thinks Japan when they travel, because it's the most mainstream. But the musicians there, and the food there, and the culture, there's almost no language barrier. A lot of people speak English. And just like, it was really great to connect to that culture that I had no experience in. And it was a little bit more familiar for me than being in Japan and Korea. But I ended up going back in January, last month, right? Today's February 1st. I went back last month for almost a month, and I was playing there. Theresa actually helped me set up some stuff for my first time there. So I was getting to play with Taiwanese musicians and connect with all these people and go to sessions and I hosted a jam session there, which was kind of by accident, which is another story. But it was really great to explore all these different scenes around the world, which I really recommend. If you're traveling as a musician and you're a jazz musician, you know, go to the jam sessions that are happening in that town so that you can get to know these people, because they're just like you.
Speaking of international thing, let's continue with the tune, which is sort of international. Guys, have you seen Blue Giant yet? Have you seen Blue Giant yet? You know, but you know of the manga, right? It is the manga that based on three jazz musicians, a saxophonist, a drummer, and a pianist. And Hiromi Uehara was scoring for the whole entire anime movie. And so we are gonna bring out the theme song, Blue Giant. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
play a Piazzolla piece. Wow, we never thought of playing this standard this way. So this tune is Marian McPartland, which is the main motivation I would like to do this kind of show title concert. Marian McPartland's Piano Jazz at NPR website. There are so many archives that you can check out. And Marian McPartland started the show in 1978. And she invited not just only pianists, but also some instrumentalists, including Michael Brecker, Randy Brecker, as well as Diana Krall, and many, many others. And the show lasted until 2011, when she was about 90 years old. So Marian McPartland was the biggest reason for me to continue a career as a performing educator. So have you listened to more episodes from the shows of the series?
Yeah, I've been listening to that show on and off for a long time. I think one of the more iconic ones was with Brad Meldow for me, and I think Chick Corea was also on there too, right?
He has been on the show twice. Mm-hmm. So it was the 1978 show with Chick Corea. Marian McPartland just decided, I'm gonna go ahead and improvise something free and create a different miniatures called portrait. And she was like, let me do a portrait of you. And the sound of
the a
beautiful canva just came right out in front of you. So that was actually my doctoral project. Part of my doctoral project on women in jazz, especially the pianist. Marian McPartland was the first person I studied on, and she actually had a strong tie with the community, music community in Rochester, New York, because Alec Wilder, who is the jazz and the writer, and she actually took over his show because Alec Wilder was sick. And then he asked Marian to take over, and then it became Piano Jazz today. Mm-hmm. So before we are moving on to our the final tune, please share your part of your teaching career and your upcoming gigs and projects to everybody.
I just got hired at Austin Community College doing an adjunct jazz piano, which I'm really excited about. But before that, I was doing IT, which I could not wait to get out of. So just pro tip, if you decide to do something else besides music for a little bit, probably try for a year, and then it's probably safe to go back to music after that, because that's how long I lasted. I couldn't wait to get back into music, and it was actually in Taiwan where I was there that I got the offer, and everything happened so fast. So my first semester starts February 12th, and I'm pretty excited about it. But before that, I was teaching on and off jazz piano. I really enjoy working with beginner piano students, like true beginner piano students. But I also really like working with jazz pianists, but more so teaching improvisation to like instrumentalists, what you recently started doing. I really enjoy working with all kinds of instrumentalists, not just piano, because for me, there's a lot of things that I want to pass down to the new generation, things that I would have done differently when I was in school. And it really makes me happy to see a lot of musicians who start off in music school and then they have really blossoming careers once they leave. And that's kind of like my motivation behind going back into teaching. And then I think for the summer, I think I'm gonna go back to Taiwan. I'm trying to record an album with some musicians there. And so I've challenged myself to write something every day for the next 30 days. It doesn't matter if it sounds terrible or not. But I think, you know, I get inspired a lot from Theresa with your album, and you write a lot of stuff and you do so many different things that it really is, it makes me want to work harder and try a lot of different things that are outside of my comfort zone.
Yeah, we are definitely looking forward to more of your works. And once again, thank you for coming to TAMUK with us.
Yeah,
thank you
very
much.
For having me. Yeah, it was good to be here and work with all the students. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, let's play the blues, E flat blues. We started our tune with E flat. Let's play a blues in E flat. Things and always used to be.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for watching the first Piano Jazz Show, and we will see you next year. Wait for the next series.